I'm Tejas Kumar, and I've been building on the web for over 20 years. Today, I run a small but effective developer relations agency where we work with developer-oriented companies to help them do great DevRel work, adding value to both sides. Today, we're here to talk about React Server Components, and we're going to talk about how React Server Components work, what they output, how they fit with React server-side rendering, and how they fit into the broader ecosystem. And the reason we're going to do that is because 1 year ago, Next.js 13 via the app router pioneered first-class support for React Server Components inside Next.js applications. That brought with it a number of questions that ideally we answer together in our time together today. To do so, we're going to look at an application that we built with React Server Components, but without Next.js 13. And we did this in a top contour rough way to understand the underlying mechanism of how these things work, and then teach it to you so that you understand the mechanism and that helps you do better work and make better decisions in your day-to-day work. To do that, let's start by exploring our application. So our application is this. This is the dog site. And what you see is a list of dog breeds. I absolutely love dogs. And if you click on Husky, you can see a photo of a Husky. If you go back and click on Bulldog, you see a photo of a Bulldog. And it's a different picture every time. It's really, really great. Okay, why are we looking at this website? Well, this website was built, as mentioned, with React Server Components. And to understand the complexity of it fully, we need to understand three concepts in particular. To start with, we need to understand React elements and how elements and components relate to one another. So let's do that. So this is ultimately a React element. A React element is just a JavaScript object. This little bracket here is a call to React.createElement. So this is kind of valid, right? And the output of React.createElement is a React element, which is this. It's an object with a schema type, props, and always one prop, children, but could be more. In fact, this is not fully accurate because there's also a type of, and this is usually a symbol for React.element. So this makes a React element. There are a number of other types of React elements, though. It's not just objects. For example, just the number one could be an element, false could be an element, null could be an element, or string. All of these are perfectly legal and valid React elements. Moreover, the type property of React elements could be a string for built-in elements like divs and spans and p tags, or could be a function to represent a function component. What is a function component? A function component is a function that closes over some state but ultimately returns JSX that becomes React elements because JSX is calls to React.createElement. Okay, so a React element is a JavaScript object or a string, a number, or a Boolean, or even an array that represents fragments. So, where the type property is either a function or a string. If the type property is async, then we start to encounter what are called server components. We'll get into those in more detail later, but fundamentally, it's really important for us to understand React elements in this way. Okay. And ideally, we do. Now let's talk about server-side rendering. To do that, we look at a very bare bones, very hacky server-side renderer to understand a little bit of the mechanism that is important to then understand server components. So to do that, we look at the server that powers this application. So we have Express. This could be Koa, this could be Fastify, this could be whatever you want, and some utilities, particularly render to string from React DOM server. Render to string is synchronous and really not the best API for this. You should ideally use render to pipeable stream or something, but for the purposes of education, we're sticking with that. Again, it's not something you probably want to use in production. So render to string we get from React DOM server, and we get some other functions. Okay. We instantiate our server. We listen to the dist or public directory for things like CSS and images and static assets. This is the meat of our server. We have a route parameter page, and this could be anything. This could be list, this could be detail, this could be literally, it's a variable, it's a parameter. We take the value of that parameter and use it in a dynamic import of a component in the pages or app directory. So rec.params.page represents the file name. We dynamically import that file from the file system's pages or app directory, and this becomes our component. The default export becomes our component. And this is why in Next.js, your pages or your functions, your components need to be the default export because Next can then infer it from the default export. Whereas if you did something like a named export, this would be pretty hard for Next.js to guess. However, default is just standardized. Okay, that's why the default export is necessary. There's some mechanism for you. So we get the component and then we pass it to render to string or render to stream, and we turn it into a string. So we turn this object into a string, and we send it over the network. And I need to be clear, every React application really is just a big nested object. So every React application that's composed of a number of elements is just this, right? Where children is further component. So this is representative of really most React applications. However, it's not P's, you know, you have an HTML, you have a head, etc. Okay. So this is head. This is our server. So now that we understand server rendering, how does server components fit into this? To do that, let's look at a server component. And let's define a server component. A server component is a component that executes only on the server. A server component never makes it to a client environment, that is a browser. And because of that, you can trust them a little bit more. You can make server requests, database requests with authentication keys. It's totally fine because it's never going to make it to your client's untrusted browser. Moreover, since your server is asynchronous, server components can be asynchronous. Let's look at a server component. To do that, we're going to check out a different branch. So we'll go here and we'll git check out the second part called unwrap. And if we come here, this is a server component. So it's an async function that can just await a fetch of dog breeds and boom, render some UI. On the server side, everything's the same, except we have an unwrap function. And this unwrap function goes through this tree of elements, really, finds async stuff and awaits it. That's literally what we're doing. So we look at JSX. And as we mentioned, JSX can be a string or a number or a Boolean. And if it is, we just return it as is. If it's an array, like a fragment, we recursively find anything async, await it, but return the awaited values. If it's an object, if that object is a React element, then if it's a string, if its type is a string, that is, it's a built-in component, then if its props are async, we await the props by recursively calling unwrap on the props. This is because you can have props where children are an async function. So we want to make sure that we await those. If it's a function component, we call the component with its props and await it. Finally, if the props are async, we await. So this function unwrap literally just like awaits everything on the server side. It makes sure all the data dependencies are handled and it's ready to go. Okay. Once that's done, we come here. And before we call render to string, we take this big tree and we pass it to unwrap JSX like this. And then this kind of waits for all the server components to finish. We get a big JavaScript object and we render that to the string and send it over the network. This is the interplay between React server components and server-side rendering. You have one step that waits for everything on the server and then you serialize that to a string or a stream and send it over the network. This should work. So let's build and run our server. Let's go back to port 3000 here. And it fails, and that it fails because we didn't await our unwrap JSX. So let's await it, try again. And there we go. So this page is fully React server components and server-side rendered. In fact, we're not using React at all on the client side. And that is the interplay between server components, server-side rendering. It's another misconception that server components output HTML strings. They don't. They output a big JavaScript object, that is React elements, that have been awaited. And because we get a big JavaScript object, we can then hand it off to the client side to do interesting things like soft navigation in Next.js 13 with the app router. Let's look at how that works. So if we check out the fourth part of our repo, client side navigation, we'll stash first, and then we'll check out part four. Let's come back here. What we're doing is something interesting. On the client side, we're rendering our React app that we get from the server. But we're adding a click event listener to the window object, such that if we click on anything that's not an anchor link, we don't do anything, we return. But if we do click on an anchor link specifically, we prevent the default behavior, that is page navigation, and we do something else. What do? We call the function navigate. And what navigate does is it fetches our server and says, hey, give me a big JSX object. Give me a big React object that represents the next page. Then we take that output, and we just like re-render our application with the next page's JSX, okay? So it's not quite navigation. It's re-rendering the next page's JSX output on the client side because we can server render now and we can server render server-side components, server components. So we get the big JSX object and just re-render it. What does that look like? Let's take a look. So our application here, if we npm run build and so on, our application has soft navigation. So if we enter some state here in this field, and we navigate to Beagle, notice the state is persistent. This is soft navigation, because what's actually happening is we're not navigating, we're just re-rendering. Let's look at that through the network tab. So if we open the network inspector, we'll see what's happening. I'll click on blue tick, and we're saying, hey, React, give me the next page's JSX. And that's what we have. We have props, children. Notice HTML, children is head and body. So it's an entire page, right? And this page has children and children and children, but we're handing the next page over to React and saying, just re-render with this next page. That way we can persist state and do soft navigation, giving that fluid UX that you get from Next.js applications. The even better part of this is it's progressively enhanced. So yes, we do have soft navigation. State is persisted. That's really great. But suppose we don't have JavaScript. We still navigate, though state isn't persisted. So it's a progressive enhancement. Let's look at that. So if we come here and, like, you know, just disable JavaScript. So we'll still navigate because we're still fundamentally using anchor links, except the state is lost. And this is really great because JavaScript now enhances the page, but doesn't replace the page, the true intention of JavaScript. Hey, thanks for watching. I hope this has made it really clear what server components are, what they output, these big JSX objects instead of HTML, how soft navigation works, and how they fit into server-side rendering. If you're learning from and or enjoying this talk, I want to just plug, if I can, briefly, that I'm writing a book on React, on underlying mechanism that helps you understand these things and make better decisions in your work. The book is called Fluent React. It's on sale for pre-order, and I'd recommend buying that if you're interested in supporting me and really learning about these things, because this will help you in your job and also help you get the most out of Next.js and React. Thank you for watching.